day in Manhattan, clear as could be, till the planes hit the buildings and changed history. They stood for an hour once the damage was done, but then suddenly crumbled. 10 seconds they were gone. There were cascading projections of steel into dust. It looked like explosions, but it was not disgust. So I turn off the TV and shut out the lights. It's all just illusion right in front of my eyes. Well, I'm not scared of dying. We're all bound for heaven. I'm just sharing the truth about 9/11. Now building number 7 dropped the cleanest of all. Yet the world still knows nothing of this amazing free fall. There was no real reason. It wasn't hit by a plane. They say it was a fire, yet you can't see the flames. You see cascading projections of steel into dust. Like demolition, but it's never discussed. So I turn off the TV and shut out the lights. It's all just illusion right in front of my eyes. Well, I'm not scared of dying. We're all bound. Sharing the truth about 9/11. They say that the bigger the lie, the more people believe. And the deeper the fear, the more easily we are deceived. Turn off the TV and I shut out. Just illusion right in front of my eyes. Well, I'm not scared of dying. We're all bound for heaven. Just sharing the truth about 9/11. Yes, I'm sharing the truth about 9/11.
Howdy. It's Saturday, May 10th. This is series year 7, episode 14. Okay. In the news today, it was something that really got me. I put aside everything else that I was going to do. I think this is something that's going to be in our face for quite a while. I noticed, I was watching CNN this morning, and, you know, not more than 8 hours ago, they had pictures of fire trucks, policemen, every vehicle you can imagine with their lights on, doing this slow procession through the streets of New York. And the caption read that they were returning the 9/11 remains to the 9/11 memorial. All I have to say about that is, what a travesty. Brought to you by the people that brought you 9/11, we're now turning it into a tourist attraction at the expense of all the family's emotions. We're going to be covering that and more. We're about to start out with a video by James Corbett, and he's talking about the Pentagon admitting that they violated the bodies of the 9/11. 9/11 victims from the Pentagon, at least. We'll go ahead and play this James Corbett video, and I'll be back. We'll have a couple other videos, and then we'll open it up to a conversation.
Pentagon admits more 9/11 remains dumped in landfill. This is Behind the Headlines on Global Research TV. A new report released on Monday by the Pentagon reveals that some of the unidentifiable remains from victims at the Pentagon and Shanksville sites on September 11th were disposed of in a landfill. The details come from a report by a review committee examining operations of the Air Force Mortuary Division at Dover Air Force Base. The report notes that before 2008, disposal of unidentified remains was delegated to subcontractors. The guidelines at the time called for the contractors to incinerate the remains and dump the ashes in landfills. In a press conference earlier this week, Pentagon spokesman John Abizade confirmed that this section of the report applied to the remains of some of the victims of 9/11.
Well, I understand how sensational the notion is. There was a point where people considered going to the crematorium, and in some states it's law that that is the final disposition of the fallen.
This is not the first controversy to arise regarding the disposal of remains of 9/11 victims. In 2003, New York City medical examiner Charles Hirsch wrote that he was virtually certain that human remains from the World Trade Center had been left at the Fresh Kills landfill, where debris from the buildings had been taken to be sifted. In 2005, the city medical examiner officially ended the process of identifying remains from the debris of the World Trade Center site, with only 1,585 victims being identified by their remains. In 2007, victims' families' worst fears about what happened to the unidentified remains were confirmed by Eric Beck, a senior supervisor of the recycling facility that sifted the debris, who swore in an affidavit that some of the remains ended up in a mixture that was used to pave roads and fill potholes in New York. In 2008, Judge Alvin Hellerstein of the Federal District Court in Manhattan threw out a case by victims' family members who were petitioning for the right to continue searching the landfill for the remains of their loved ones. In 2010, the city relented and the search began again for the human remains, this time using new methods and technologies. The remains of 20 more victims were soon discovered in the rubble. The mystery of why the city fought so hard to prevent the victims' family members from continuing their search for their loved ones is compounded by the entire operation to remove and destroy the evidence from Ground Zero as quickly as possible. By September 29, 2001, just 2 weeks after the attacks, over 130,000 tons of debris had been removed from the site. In all, 185,101 tons of structural steel were hauled away from Ground Zero, most of it sold to the Chinese firm Bao Steel, which purchased it at $120 per ton, significantly below the average price of $160 paid by local U.S. steel mills. Of that 185,101 tons of steel, almost all of it was scrapped, with FEMA saving just 150 pieces of steel for further study. The Building Performance Assessment Team tasked by FEMA with writing the WTC Building Performance Study was not even allowed access to the site or to collect steel samples from the salvage yards. Even more remarkably, as firefighters like Eric Lawyer have pointed out, the destruction of evidence represented by this so-called cleanup of the site in fact violated numerous specific guidelines about the preservation of crime scene evidence for further investigation.
The NFPA 9.3.6, it covers spoliation of evidence. What it reads is once evidence has been removed from the scene, it should be maintained and not destroyed or altered until the investigation is complete. The steel was melted down prior to the investigation. We know that from their own admission. This is no conspiracy theory stuff. 19.2.4, exotic accelerants. If on the scene you find melted steel or concrete, you should consider the use of exotic accelerants. And they specifically say in the manual, thermite mixtures produce exceedingly hot fires that can account for melted steel and concrete. It also says they leave residues that can be tested for visually and chemically identifiable. Again, they did not test for it. And just put in perspective, on a routine house fire, if we suspect even the slightest use of an accelerant, we're going to test for it when there's no fatalities, when there's very little property damage. So to not do it on this, there is absolutely no excuse. I can't drive that point home enough.
In the wake of the latest revelations regarding the dumping of 9/11 victims' remains in landfills, the Pentagon is being forced to justify their conduct and guidelines, and pressure is mounting for those in charge of this desecration to lose their job. So far, no one has lost their job or even been reprimanded for the frequent and flagrant violation of protocols and crime scene requirements regarding the disposal of 9/11 evidence. At this time, there's still no word from the FBI or New York City officials about how they were able to discover nearly intact passports from the World Trade Center site on the day of 9/11, but have yet to account for nearly 1,000 human bodies.
And it was in one of those areas, a couple of blocks away from the World Trade Center site, apparently, where that passport was found. The FBI announcing that it has found the passport of one of the hijackers who was on board one of those two planes that hit the Twin Towers on Tuesday morning. They then mounted an intensive search in that area for more evidence, and those kinds of searches continue at this hour, as does the work on site there. As you mentioned, Building 7 behind me, which is still smoking several days after it came crashing down. The building itself...
Seven still smoking several days after, not several days, but how about months? We had molten steel still being exposed months after the event. But what we just heard was an example. I mean, they could find the passport that survived all the fires and everything, but over 1,000 people are still missing. Well, this is quite a circus that they got going. Now they're going to pretend that they, you know, really revere the hallowed bones of the poor tragic victims. And in the meantime, they're going to charge you admission. But what we're going to do now, this is, I think it's an AP feed. I'm not sure. You'll see what the tag is. I forget. But this is a, you know, 8 hour ago coverage of the procession through New York City, showing the solemnity that they're giving it. If you guys are ready, go ahead and take it away. Yeah, come on down to the 9/11 Museum. We've got all the fragments. Come and see the grizzly bone fragments remaining from all this tragedy. Come on down. We have videos of people jumping from buildings. Come on down. And for the low price, you can also have a bed and breakfast. That's right. Come on down. New York is your vacation mecca. Oh, did I use mecca? Sorry. Your vacation Bethlehem or something. I don't know. I got to be religiously correct, right? Well, anyway. Horse Pucky. You see at the end there when the 9/11 families put on the gags? And it says it all, doesn't it? That a museum is not a cemetery. Where's the respect? Well, you didn't get to see the procession of vehicles with their emergency lights on, but you saw them carrying full coffins. Now, didn't they just say that there were just little tiny fragments? What do? Take 5-gallon buckets and fill up those coffins till they're full? Okay, next coffin. 1,000 different remains in each coffin, blah, and we're going to put them on display at the museum, the 9/11 museum, where you can come on down and see what terrorism has brought you. The only thing they're not telling you is that the same people that are rebuilding, the same people that are bringing you this museum, are the people who brought you 9/11. You understand what I'm saying? That's what the travesty is. And we're going to have this museum memorialize the official cartoon, the official fiction of 9/11. We're going to memorialize it. And they're already corrupting the minds of our children by telling them that we were attacked by Muslims on 9/11. It's a lie, folks. It's a lie, lie, lie. The only activity that any people with a Muslim, even just a Muslim heritage, had in this whole thing was working for the CIA as patsies to give, you know, somebody something to be mad at. Somebody, you know, a scapegoat. That's the only thing that Muslims had to do with it. And then they were just about as Muslim as I am Christian. I mean, my family heritage is Christian, but that's all. You see what I'm saying? Those guys were just as Muslim. It's crazy. Anyway, we got one more real quick video, and then we're going to bring Alex back, and we're going to open up the phones. So get ready to start dialing in, and we'll flash the phone number when we come back. But, you know, we just saw a brief glimpse at the end there about what the protesters were feeling. So this next clip shows the protesters' point of view. Yeah, that was a poorly chosen clip. It didn't really explain anything, but you saw them milling around. But part of the controversy is that they're going to be charging. Now, I don't know what they're doing for the known identified victim fragments, but apparently they're charging admission so you can go pay your respects to the unknown fragments, you know, like the unknown soldier. Go ahead and put the phone number up. And by the way, Dave, take a look through that list and see if you find anything in the vein of what we're talking about that might be useful on that YouTube page there. But the phone number's on the top of the screen now, 288-4448. If you'd like to talk to us about this subject, or we could talk about some other subject too, but, you know, it's clear to me. Did you pay any attention during the JFK anniversary at, you know, no matter how much we know about the JFK assassination, we have a signed deathbed confession on video with witnesses that E. Howard Hunt was the head of the assassination squad that took care of Kennedy. There are other details well known. The Congress has even it reinvestigated the Kennedy assassination and concluded that it was a conspiracy. There was more than one person. And yet, when they had the anniversary, they kept out any protesters out of Dealey Plaza, and the entire media was lockstep promoting the original Warren Commission report, even after it's been thoroughly discredited. The same thing with 9/11. That's what they're going to do. We're going to keep seeing this cartoon 9/11 Commission report glorified.
Good topic tonight, Bill. And here they are supposedly remembering the victims of 9/11, but what about the aftermath of 9/11? What about all those millions and millions and millions of bodies, people in other countries, and countries that they choose to target, and invoking the memory of 9/11, a moment that terrified so many people around the world, a manufactured event. That's sick and that's twisted, and I think what we're seeing right now is a ritual. In fact, a black magic ritual.
We're exporting terrorism.
Being played out before the world.
We are exporting terrorism, especially in the form of drones. And a side deal about the kidnapping of the Nigerian girls, you know, that's over 200. The slave trade, both white and black slaves all over the world, is flourishing, and our government has their fingers in it. But I just want to point out that with all the drones and all the hype that we give, you know, the propaganda that they give us about drones, you know, how they're going to be the future of safety. They're going to be able to find lost children. They're going to be able to do all kinds of things that we just haven't been able to do before. Oh, but we can't let you use them to find stolen Nigerian girls.
Of course not.
No,
we have a global surveillance society, and
we've decided no, we aren't going to help with that. Where we could, they're so stupid. They missed a beautiful PR event. If they went ahead and turned in that part of their own network, well, like they do, kind of like with Al Qaeda, every once in a while they go after an Al Qaeda head or something. Well, they could go after one of their minions in their own slave trade, turn them in, and do it with the aid of drones, and they could have made a propaganda coup. But no, they're too stupid. They just want to treat you like sheep. Well, anybody interested in calling in?
We live in a crazy world. We certainly do, because every time I turn around, somebody out there is pulling the racism card. And what's sad about that
is that divide and
there
conquer.
Are issues of racism that should be discussed. When they start going into different countries, and people start looking the other way when they think it doesn't affect them, they're choosing to believe that they're not affected because it's those people over there that are being bombed. It's distant from us. And we watch it on TV, we see it on Fox, and we see it on CNN, we see it on MSNBC, and we go, but we're safe. We're Americans. We're distant from that. And we don't have any role to play in that, even though there are many people that have voted either Democrat or Republican. And if you voted either Democrat or Republican, you're a part of the mass way of thinking. It doesn't mean that there's not good in you. But when we compromise and we start voting in what we think is with the people, oftentimes other people suffer. And if we don't have that sense of empathy in regards to the real victims of 9/11, the millions, and the Pentagon said years ago, they're no longer counting the bodies. They are no longer counting the bodies as of several years ago. You know, we live in a unfortunate time in our nation's history, in our planet's history, where to show emotion, anger, is frowned upon in today's society. When we're just supposed to be happy with all these circuses, as they have made Ground Zero a circus itself. In today's world, the average person that's listening, that's believing the mass way of thinking, thinks that a well-adjusted person is happy with all of this sickness and all of this death. And that's not true at all. There is something normal about having emotion in regards to these issues. So a lot of people have said to me over the years, Alex, why do you even care about 9/11 and the truth behind 9/11? Nobody cares. But there certainly is new layers, and new layers, we'll get to that phone call in a moment, of propaganda that is directed towards the average man and woman to keep them afraid and keep them in memory of that moment when they were scared, you know whatless. So 9/11 is still very much an issue as long as they continue to invade country after country and turn our country into a nightmarish police state where young girls and young children and the wives of men are groped right before them in an airport.
That's
in
right.
In my opinion, that is a ritual. That is baby stepping your way to the dark side when you start allowing that type of thing to happen to your children in order to travel.
Well, obviously, the TSA routine of groping everybody, they admit, I mean, in their own writings, they admit it has nothing at all to do with safety or security. It's simply about conditioning you to a police state. That's in their writing. Okay? They think you're too stupid to read it. You know, but read it. In fact, you should read both sides. You know, don't, if you're a lefty person, don't just read left stuff. Read the right stuff so you understand what the other side is mounting against you. You know, but anyway, we've got a call, so let's go ahead and take that call.
Good evening.
We need more
gentlemen.
Volume.
Hello?
Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, okay. Yeah, good evening. You opened the program with your comment about the World Trade Center victims and stuff, and you mentioned you saw it on CNN, I think.
Yeah.
And I had to chuckle. I thought, oh, well, so they pulled away from the Malaysia airline coverage to air that, huh? Okay. So CNN's probably right back onto Malaysia Airlines. But anyway, that's not why I called. A couple of weeks ago, I was watching C-SPAN's morning call-in program, and they had a gentleman there, a former FBI, former CIA, talking about, and I forget the exact nature of the topic that he was talking about, but a caller from Tillamook, Oregon, phoned in during the program and began asking about reopening the investigation 9/11? Into World Trade Center 7.
Cool.
And the caller was very polite and non-conspiratorial and everything. He was just asking why isn't anything being done about this? And of course, the guest on the program, the former FBI, former CIA, launched right into 19 hijackers, 3,000 dead, terrible attack, blah blah blah. Well, if I could suggest to your worldwide viewers that whenever any kind of a question is brought up, whenever they choose to engage these people, don't even let them begin to divert the conversation away from simple high school physics on Building 7. And in fact, stay away from the two towers. Those were hit by airplanes. Building 7 wasn't hit by anything except maybe a little bit of debris. Do not let these people divert the topic away from simple high school physics and focus on 19 hijackers, twin towers, two airplanes, blah blah blah. So
thank
anyway,
you, caller.
That. And then the other thing, and Alex, this is probably going to be right up your alley for a future program. Later that same day, I watched a program about something called wide area surveillance, and it was the program focused on a program in Compton, California, where they have an airplane. It's not a drone; it's a regular civilian, Cessna-looking thing with a high definition
like we have here in Multnomah County.
Basically, circles around over the city all day long taking pictures. And then what the police will do is if they get a 911 call about a robbery or some kind of illegal activity, they can backtrack on that footage that they've been taking all day long, focus in on the area in question where the 911 call was supposedly originating, and then look at all the traffic and the people and everything and try to pinpoint, what car was there at that time.
The police
and
already use blimp surveillance.
Well, Jesus, you got to hope you're not driving by when something like that happens because, maybe they'll target your pickup truck instead of the other guy's pickup truck.
Well,
but anyway, thank you both for the program.
Denial.
I want to thank your, I guess I'm cut off.
Yeah, not yet, all but right. You... Yeah, okay.
I don't recall anybody cutting him off, but...
No, he wasn't cut off, but...
Yeah, he cut himself off, but...
I was trying to cut him off, but that was
the
just...
The point is, and we got the point, we're in a surveillance society, not new information. I would suggest that we start watching over the people that are trying to blow the whistle, not forget about them. Yeah. Not forget about them as they fall down the holes of the system.
Now, remember, we were just talking about the programming that they're doing to us. You know, one of my favorite TV shows is Person of Interest. Now, if you've ever seen that show, the premise is that there's a guy created a gigantic computer that monitors everything, and the government has taken it for its own purposes, but you know, he still has a back door into it, the creator does, of that program. And anyway, he goes around saving people that the machine would normally ignore. But in the process of this whole thing, it's just completely going crazy. First of all, giving you the misconception that everything not only is hackable, but hackable that fast. You know, just instantly, just quicker than you can think about it, they can hack it. Which, you know, to some extent might be true, but the whole idea of this machine, I mean, this program is getting you used to, yeah, you're watching it for entertainment and it's fun to watch and you get all excited, but after the show's done, you go away saying, yeah, man, that's real. That's real. They're really talking about real stuff, man. You know, and I think it's to build up the mythology of the surveillance state as well. We just got another caller. So go ahead, caller.
Hello?
Hello.
Yeah, I was just wondering if you guys could touch on the deal about the Pentagon when that was bombed. Something about, I don't know, this had something to do with the gold supply and stuff and records that were kept there at the Pentagon and that were destroyed. supposedly it was a weird deal. And then the photos they show you of the explosion and stuff from the Pentagon. I don't know, I was hearing that was all bogus, and I was just curious if they knew anything about that.
Well, there are something like, what, 84 cameras that filmed the whatever hit the Pentagon were confiscated immediately by the FBI, some within, you know, half a minute after the attack. I mean, that might just be folklore. But anyway, very quickly, everything was confiscated. I know the employees were watching video of the event on top of the Sheraton Hotel when the FBI confiscated that and then swore every one of them to silence. And so they must have seen it. So there were some people that actually saw what happened and could testify and didn't have anything to do with it, but still are remaining silent. So
far as the gold, there's all types of people that are trying to find out where that went.
Now,
that's the part that I didn't understand. Is they were saying something about that they now are claiming that all the records to that was destroyed.
Well, here's that might be getting mixed up with the deal about the...
And there's billions of dollars or something that
the
are
day
missing.
Before, the day before the 9/11 event, Rumsfeld came out and announced that there was $2.3 trillion of the Pentagon budget that they could not account for. It was missing. And they mounted a giant CPA attack on it with all kinds of accountants. And it just so happened, just curiously, that the wedge of the Pentagon that they had just remodeled to be terrorist-proof, to make it missile-proof, is where they had those accountants, and that's where whatever it was hit the Pentagon and blew them and killed them all dead. And there went all the records that they were investigating into that $2.3 trillion. You know, that's a pretty good motive for doing it, you know, beyond terrorism. Somebody didn't want that information to come out, but...
Well, it definitely would have been in a planned plot. I mean... Or, you know, all that to have been a sequence that happened the way it did.
There was a lot of other gold, too. There was gold in reservoirs, or, you know, what do they call them? Not reservoirs, but vaults below the towers.
Correct.
And they found, you know, trucks. One of them still had some gold in it, but they found empty trucks underneath the building. That it's like that Bruce Willis movie where they... It's funny... I wonder where they got the idea for that movie, or vice versa.
Yeah, it makes you wonder, doesn't it? Well, I don't know. It just makes you wonder about our government and how honest they are with the public. And there must be an awful lot of corrupt people there.
Well, what do you think about them using the remains of the dead in this big ceremony now to, you know, kind of advertise their new vacation spot, the 9/11 memorial.
I don't even want to comment on that. You know, if you know what I'm talking about. Yeah.
Well, thanks for calling.
I don't want to comment on that.
Any other callers? Are there any other callers that want to comment on this? Does this bother you at all? Do you find it standard operating procedure?
Well, I would have to say I do.
Well, I thought the caller was gone.
Surprise me too much of our government doing that. That's what you're getting at.
Yeah, well, I'm not surprised after everything we talk about on the, you know, state crimes against democracy side of this issue. It's something that doesn't get talked about. There, you know, all this 9/11 talk that's going on today, they're, you know, talking about, the biggest terrorist attack on American soil, blah, 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 blah. Does it count as a terrorist attack if we do it to ourselves?
You know, to kind of move this forward to current events, there are a lot of people that are...
Thanks, caller.
Thank you. A lot of people that are caught up in this hysteria that the Muslims are invading. I don't know if you've heard this one. You know, pick your article from XYZ website here.
Yeah, there are sleeper cells all
around.
And
it doesn't mean that there aren't cultural differences between the East and the West in different parts of the world. This has been this way for some time. This is not a new revelation. But with mass media, with psyops, with intelligence agencies, with the ability to create problems, so the government institutions have some sort of a pretext to say, hey, look at this situation that we have here. You know, we have these women getting whipped. We have to invade. We have to intervene. And you mentioned the situation in Nigeria earlier. And we have Michelle Obama saying, bring back our girls. Well, what about the problems that we have here in the United States? What about those contractors that rape women, kidnap little girls, while they were occupying parts of Afghanistan and Iraq? How many times do we take a moment? We'll get to that phone call in just a moment. How many times do we take just a second to reflect on how many people's lives have been disrupted by this ongoing occupation in the Middle East? And out of that number, or any number, how many ever have that light bulb go off above their head and go, oh, wait a minute.
You bring up the excellent point.
If what goes around comes around, what is going to be the future of this country? Oh. And where will our safety be if our government is willing to kill 3,000 of us in order to push this agenda for a new world order forward?
Well, that's another point, a couple of points there. First of all, they keep talking about the 3,000 that died on 9/11, the 3,000 that died. Oh, man, there were so many more people than 3,000 that died because of this 9/11 terrorist attack by our own government. And we were just talking about it, you know, and we never mentioned those, what type of casualty is that? Collateral damage, you know. And that's the deepest they ever think about it, is collateral damage. Otherwise, it's a statistic. You know, one man dies, and it's a tragedy. A million people die, and it's a statistic. Yeah.
And even though they may not want to deal with it, at some point we're going to have to. At some point, we're going to have to. Each of us individually, whatever we do, whatever we put out there, comes back to us. Well, it's part of natural law. It's a law of the universe. It will not be violated. It will not be broken. What we put out there comes back to us on the small scale and the largest scale. I believe that. Mm-hmm. So for those of us on the right side of history, keep doing what you're doing. Don't get caught up in the fear or the psyops, because there's a whole other game that's engineered to shut us up.
Now think about this. We know about the economics of forming a criminal group called Al-Qaeda to use as the neighborhood thugs who break the windows for the owner of the glass company at night, you know, and we're the owner of the glass company. We understand that economics, but now take it one step further. While spreading all this, you know, lying propaganda about how Muslims are responsible for all this, it and all the deaths that were raining down on Muslims, we are actually creating hate out there. We're creating the Muslim enemy that we didn't have on 9/11, but that we do have now. And guess what? That's another economic coup, because now they don't have to spend as much money buying Al-Qaeda, because now it's self-fueling. Well, you know, it's just amazing how they do this and manipulate. It's about time that, I mean, the people that are fighting for Al-Qaeda don't know that they're fighting for the West. They think that they're fighting for their own Muslim causes. Only their bosses know, and the ones who get rich from the West. You know, and it's amazing how stupid the Al-Qaeda minions are. They must not watch my show.
They certainly aren't.
Sorry, I don't mean to be flip on such a heavy occasion.
And
but
the other backlash.
It's the only way I can stay sane.
It is the morale that falls. Once people wake up to these truths, they may not see the global syndicate that's behind all of this. They may just see the current president or the past president. They may just see the United States. But behind that, you have the quote-unquote Wizard of Oz, you have the powers that be that have engineered this to destroy this country.
President after president comes and goes, and our foreign policy never changes. You notice there, you don't get to be considered for president unless you can fight the war better than the last guy. You know, what? What type of absolutely corrupt society have we become?
All right. Well, we see that phone call.
Go ahead and send that phone call through. Whoa! Fell over. Almost fell over. Sorry. That's why my mama told me don't lean back in my chair.
Caller, are you with us?
Yes, good morning. Afternoon, excuse me. You there?
Yeah, go ahead.
Time is relative. Yeah. Go ahead.
If we were going to reopen the investigation of 9/11, what would be the very first question? What would be the very first question if, you know, all can go by detectives that we grew up with? Mannix, Barnaby Jones, Jessica of Murder, She Wrote. What would be the very first question they would have? And the very first question they would have is, what do all five attack sites have in common? And what all five attack sites have in common is, all five attack sites are high-speed data centers. The one in Pennsylvania, it hit its target. It was an underground data center. The same thing with the Pentagon and the three towers. They were data centers, high-speed data centers, and they had to wipe them out to make our country, our military, blind.
Can you give us a reference where we can find information? On all these years, I've never, ever heard that reference.
Of what?
About Pennsylvania being some sort of a data center.
Well, we have underground data centers all around the country. We have here in Oregon.
No, I want to know about Pennsylvania.
Like banks, they have underground data centers.
No, I mean, just because they could doesn't mean they do. I want to know how you know they do.
Do what?
Have an underground center there that was targeted.
They're secret. You're not supposed to know it.
Well, how do you know it?
Huh?
How do you know it?
Deduction.
Okay, we've had enough of this caller. He's obviously some sort of a kook. Go ahead and cancel that. I mean, God, you get down to the... You start questioning, and it all falls apart, doesn't it?
I think...
Don't lose your critical thinking ability, folks.
There'll be another caller after this. I just want to say in brief, the 9/11 issue is very important to me, but it's important that we don't stay stuck on the very specific details.
Right.
There are some people that go into this, and it's a rabbit hole that goes into some places that it can get a little bit weird. But there's a greater understanding that comes from an understanding that there are criminal, super hyper villains that are running these intelligence agencies. We just mentioned human trafficking earlier. You know, women being violated is a whole other dark side that goes with things like 9/11. And it sends us up to the top of pyramid, if you will, that there's a system of slavery that we have to expose. It is our duty as a sentient human being with feelings and emotions, unless someone's already been corrupted by this evil, how could you not speak against it and all the other evils that we see? It's all connected, and that's the point of shows like this.
Okay, we got a caller again. Go ahead, call.
Yeah, about that Pennsylvania plane crash. I think that somebody seriously needs to dig that thing up. Either a government or somebody put a website up and get donations or something.
If you go on the internet, you'll find out that there are claims that 93% of that plane has already been recovered and reassembled, just like we always do. The funny thing is, I've never heard of that, and I don't know where you could go see that plane either.
Is it like in that blimp hangar in New Jersey where they always put the planes together, like
Flight 800 or whatever it was?
Yeah,
they spent hours finding all the pieces and doing it, but then all of a sudden at Pennsylvania, what they told us at first was that, the plane hit an old mine shaft, and it kind of went bloop and folded up so that it could go down the shaft without leaving any parts on the top, but the entire plane went down that shaft, and guess what? We don't have the technology to go down the mine shaft that we've already dug ourselves and get that plane. You know, and if you go, I believe that. That's why we didn't get it. We can't do it because we don't have technology to dig a hole as deep as the hole we already dug.
That sounds like something a 6-year-old would tell you, some kind of excuse. The plane went in and covered itself up. And number two, that's the one plane crash where if they didn't recover anything, it went in there and filled itself in. All the evidence is right there. That's better than gold.
Yeah, if it's there, it's still there.
Yeah,
we can go get it.
I heard there's a wallet conveniently up on the surface of the planet there, right next to the hall with the terrorist ID in it.
Hey, but the same thing about the thermite, because there's a big controversy. People seem to think that they can reverse entropy and have these complex chemical structures, nanostructures, self-assemble from that's not the way entropy works, but they want you to believe that so that you don't think that thermite is a possibility. They want they strictly try to get you to disregard the thermite. Now the problem is that just like this Mount St. Helens ash, we have mountains of it. You can go out to one of those piles of it and dig down about 3 feet and find pristine, undamaged ash, just like it was, when it was laid down. The same thing with the 9/11 ash. They have mountains of it. And by the statistics, there's tons and tons and tons and tons of thermite in it. Thermite residue and thermite, unreacted thermite. Tons of it!
Well, I suspected thermite right away. I told my little brother, watching all the buildings come down, I said, back in the service, they used to have a thermite bomb to slip down a third of a tank when you got to leave it behind to melt that barrel down so it can't be fired at your ass when you're taking off,
And Kevin Ryan... one of the chemists who's been instrumental in doing a lot of work about 9/11 reported on the connections between members of the 9/11 Commission and the nanothermite industry, the military nanothermite explosives industry. People in the 9/11 Commission had ties to that industry, and they're saying, we don't know anything about it. Thermite? That's not possible. You can't do that with thermite, can you? I don't think so. No, I never heard of it. And their own industries brag about nanothermite having the highest explosive over any other, more than RDX, pound for pound, ounce for ounce, more bang for the buck, and more energy for the pound than any other explosive. And you hear people saying thermite isn't explosive. No, but nanothermite can be. And guess what? They advertise it as the best value for buying an explosive now. Better than RDX and C4. So that's the state of the art. And these guys that are in it deny it.
When that second tower came down there, where the one with the smaller piece at the top, like a couple floors below, blew out, and it was like about 8-10 stories that dropped down. The only way that damn thing could work by just looking at it from a layman's eyes, that top was made out of like solid lead, and the bottom was made out of nothing but soda crackers.
Well, yeah. Architects and engineers for 9/11 Truth use a graphic that shows a vertical. They start out by showing horizontal a great big semi truck and a little Volkswagen. They're going to hit head on, and then they say, "Well, what's going to happen? The Volkswagen is going to be crushed, and the truck will be basically unharmed, right?" Isn't it the same if you tip it up like this, so the Volkswagen's up and the truck is like this? And then everybody goes, now I get it. Yeah.
Yeah, a bunch of explanations made by a six-year-old. Thanks for taking my call.
Thank you.
I think in time more people will wake up to the fact that the truth is far different than that which they've been told. But I think that it's going to be skewed, and it already has been, in more of a perspective that it was just a Bush job, George W. Bush. It was just an inside job on the part of the United States.
But there is
something far larger to how they pulled off 9/11 and convinced the whole world it went down a certain way.
Multiple groups all over the world were involved. It's not just the United States.
You talked about these tons and tons of nanotechnology and whatnot, nanothermite. Mm-hmm. But where is it? We do know that some of it went to China.
Oh, yeah, they mean the steel.
Outside the jurisdiction of the United States.
Not that ash, but the actual steel.
The actual steel itself.
Yeah. And before anybody had a chance to examine much of it.
Right.
But you know what? We were talking about don't get lost in the minutiae. And that's exactly true. Now, David Chandler and I put together a video recently where David talks about just three different main solid scientific points that are not matters of opinion. You can't argue with them. They're irrefutable. And any one of them is enough to demand another investigation. And I'm getting the type of comments... The type of comment I've seen on YouTube in response to that is, where do you get these goofballs? They'll say anything to try to make money from a video. You know, that's the best that they're coming up with to counter this. So, you know, keep up your guns, folks. The science is winning.
People like that comment a lot on the internet usually don't create their own content. But let me just say...
That's right. You go and check out the site of the people making those comments, and you'll find out they don't even have any videos of their own, and anything they do post is hate-oriented.
You know, today, sometimes people may want me to convince them of the 9/11 truth, and what I will try to figure out real quick is if they're trying to be argumentative about that, because if someone has it determined in their mind that they're going to argue against you, they will find a way to argue against you. Now, if they have a genuine open mind and they cannot conceive that our own government and other governments were involved in a massive global cover-up to invade the Middle East and pillage its resources, things like lithium, things like heroin, things like many, many other things, we send them in the direction of Building 7. We talk about United Airlines and American Airlines, the insider trading.
Right.
How did they know something was going to happen that day to motivate those CEOs to put the put options on the airlines?
And those put options were exercised by a top CIA official.
There are other reports about the Russian government having troops outside of Afghanistan, I think in a neighboring country like Uzbekistan. And for whatever reason, the Russians had their eye on the Taliban prior to 9/11. Now, the Taliban themselves, a lot of people would say, and do say, even some Afghans, well, the United States should be there, otherwise the Taliban would be in control. Well, wait a minute. Who financed the Taliban? Even until the last days, we can at least find the ISI, which is Pakistan's intelligence. But who do we find when we find the ISI? We find the CIA behind the ISI. We still find Western backing. So people need to wake up. Marines that don't know about this should have this knowledge dropped on their doorstep that our government's involved in funding the enemy indefinitely.
And who do you see always at the base of these Middle East conflicts that are supposed to be the rebels? Well, you have the Al-Qaeda rebels, which were the CIA construct. And then, of course, you have the Muslim Brotherhood, which was an MI6 construct. So the British invented the Muslim Brotherhood, and the Americans, and with the help of the English, invented Al-Qaeda. So those are our people that we injected there. Now the people doing the work, they think they're fighting for their own cause, but that's just because they're down at the patsy level. But
there is a 2006 report of British troops caught with turbans.
Oh, yeah.
They were arrested. So it's actually documented that they were dressed up.
More covert false flag.
Right. A couple other points about 9/11. If no one's ever thought about this, look at the millions dead. Does this seem like a fair number? Look at the destruction that's been waged on not only the third world, but the police state here in the United States. Really groping a little girl? Seriously? Programming us to literally, you know, go through these cages, Really? How dumb can you be? Seriously, what did they put in that food? What did they put in that burger? What did they put in that water? What did they put in that cigarette? And we start to look in these areas and we realize we have a contaminated food supply. So there's actually a connection between poor diet, propaganda, other forms of indoctrination, and believing the ridiculous. And then we look at Sandy Hook and we look at some of these mass shootings. The world has become an insane asylum. But to bring this back to 9/11 real quick, people need to look at the fact that when the tower went down, the first tower, that was the second tower to get hit. That wasn't even the first tower. The way the order of the towers going down wasn't in sync with the order in which they were hit those airplanes.
I see what you mean.
So in a way, some of this, for whatever reason, you're free to have your opinion as to why. Some of this has been put out there in plain sight. What about the 911 days between 9/11 and Madrid?
Oh.
The Madrid train bombs.
I don't go with that numerology stuff.
You don't have to focus
stuff,
in on one
just,
thing.
Just an interesting coincidence.
Or not so much new. It's an interesting coincidence. So wherever you start in the question mark area, you're going to find yourself in the center going, not in Kansas anymore. Go ahead.
I'd like to make a comment about a question that was brought up before. You know, what would be your first question? How would you go about investigating 9/11? And, you know, first of all, I do it from multiple angles, but one of the most important angles is the stand down that had to occur for any of these planes to fly around for the hours that they did.
Fundamental.
And you start out with the lowest guy on the string and said, okay, who told you not to respond? Well, it was Colonel somebody. So then you go to Colonel somebody. And each one of these is under the threat of perjury so that if they lie, they can really be socked too. And when you start getting up a little bit higher, you start saying, okay, we'll give you immunity if you tell us who told you. And you go up that chain and you keep using that tool till you get to the top. That's how it really works in the real world. But you have to have subpoena power. And you have to have the threat of penalty of perjury to pull it off. And they didn't do that, by the way, with the 9/11 Commission.
And what percentage of the American public has heard that recording when that fighter jet pilot said, is this real?
Oh, yeah, is this real world or is this a drill?
Is this a drill? We know there are drills taking place, but we don't know if this is real.
And Michael Rupert, remember, told us about how many?
22.
22 different drills going on. It's a record number of exercises.
And that's not normal. They don't do drills like that every day. They weren't doing drills like that the day before. They weren't doing drills like that the day after. They were doing that same time, same place, 9/11.
Well, we've only got 2 minutes left, and we'll come back again next week and continue the discussion like we always do. There's, you know, we never run out of material. We always have way too much to talk about. I've got hours and hours of roll-ins that I've never played that just kind of get by the wayside, and we move on. Something new comes up, but I kind of hope that some of the stuff that we talk about, we don't hit very well, but it lets you know that there's something to investigate there. And you all have the same power we do to go and use the internet before it turns into Internet 2, where you don't get to do this research. Use it before you lose it. Okay, folks? Everybody out there can be contributing.
Well, glad to be here, Bill. And the last 30 seconds, I got a graphic there, if they can bring it up.
Oh, yeah, see if you can find Alex's graphic.
Personal information, the message number and phone number. Been back a few months, still looking for work, shelter, places to park a truck. Won't get long-winded on it now. Let's just say I've been not so successful, but my hopes are up, and the show will be back in 2 months.
Oh, yeah,
that's
and
my
I did
phone number, my email, trying to find a place to park the truck, trying to find work, trying to assimilate back into Portland. Wow, how populated Portland has become in the last few months.
And somebody sent me an email about my house thing, and I'm going to follow up on that. I really want to thank you for that, and but I haven't responded on my email yet, so I thought I'd tell you now. Okay, see you next week when we come back with episode 15.